Good evening, dandies. Welcome to Undetermined, the podcast.
Hello.
Here we are.
John, nice to finally get to talk to you.
Yes.
This is great. Thank you so much for having me. Really appreciate it.
Oh, man, thanks for coming on.
Yeah.
I appreciate you been digging back through the episodes and say you enjoy the show. That's always good to hear.
Yeah.
It's become my total, like, kind of binge listen while I'm riding my bike or whatever right now.
That's cool.
Here.
I mean, I'm a little cowed by the company I'm keeping here. You know, like the last one I listened to, I think, was the Matthew Chamberlain, episode. And I'm like, oh, my God, there's a guy who actually knows what he's doing, like back and forth. And now we've got the guy who just bangs on the guitar and screams a little bit.
Nah, man, selling yourself short.
Yeah.
Definitely more worthy than that. Yeah, I've been listening to They Birds a lot over the course of the last couple of days since I bought them. Looking forward to getting my record, itching for that.
Yeah, thanks so much for the order. I threw a couple extras in there for you. So, you know, hopefully.
Oh, cool.
So I need to do that. I was waiting for Bandcamp Friday.
Oh, that's awfully nice of you. My line on Bandcamp Friday is that if any organization has ever earned its cut, it's Bandcamp.
Yeah.
And, you know, so I almost feel bad when people, I mean, I appreciate it. It's like, you know, my heart grows three times every time somebody wants to make sure that we get every penny. Mm-hmm. Just so you know, we have no problem with those people getting their money.
All right. Well, fuck you. I'll order it tomorrow.
Yeah. I actually, right when I messaged you that, and I was like, oh, yeah, I want to buy this album. And I was like, yeah, I just bought your album. I got hit with the fraud department thing from my bank.
Oh, no. Well, that's because we funnel all of our money through a bank in the Caribbean. So
right.
Probably, yeah. It's the only way we can handle the volume.
He doesn't even think he's a real musician. He's a fraud.
Washed by the Yakuza and the Russian mob. But no, it's actually turns out it's because I'm buying too much shit on Bandcamp is what it is.
Oh, God. Yeah.
And I think somebody's hacked me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Totally.
Well, when the wife asks, yeah, baby, that's totally what happened.
Yeah. Well, I don't know what that is.
Exactly.
She'll come back to me. Don't worry. They're going to prosecute some guy named John in Chicago.
I'll be long gone by then, Matt. I'll be long gone.
Go out of the clink.
Yeah. skip town on that treasure.
Yeah.
So the two of you, you're in Missouri and Kansas City, mm-hmm. right? That's where the two of you, I mean, I know. So Matt, you're in Kansas City and John, you're in Columbia. Is that right?
Yep.
Because mm-hmm. I've got a little bit of history. Well, actually, Christy, the woman who was nice enough to marry me, she like spent a big chunk of grad school in Columbia. So I've been able to visit that place a lot. And I lived in Lawrence, Kansas for a long time.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, like in the mid-90s. I actually was a co-owner of a bookstore in downtown Lawrence, Kansas for a couple of years there.
Wow.
Yeah, so, you know, that would have been like 93 through 96 or something like that.
Okay.
What store?
It was called Terra Nova, and we were right down on Mass Street, like in the 900 block of Mass Street.
Mm-hmm.
And it was great. I mean, because when we were there, Burroughs was still alive, and he was a regular customer of ours.
Oh, yeah.
We had the store that was like the literary, philosophy, queer, you know, the weirdo bookstore. It was awesome. There were like three bookstores downtown. There was the place that did bestsellers, the place that did mysteries, and then there was us. You know, I would look up from the counter in the store that I own where I'm selling all of my favorite books. And like, because Burroughs lives there, Allen Ginsberg would suddenly be in my store.
Holy shit.
Richard Hell or Michael Stipe. You know, it was like, it was incredible. It was a really exciting time to be there.
Wow.
We could talk about that for an hour.
Well, my memory's not so good, so I could probably only talk about it for a little bit. Plus, there was a lot of trauma involved. You know, Borders opened up right around the corner from us back when they were expanding so insanely, and that's why we had to close. So,
yeah.
They're not doing too well now.
No. I wish I could say I had the last laugh, but I closed before they did, so I guess I can't.
Yeah.
I think Jeff Bezos did. He really had the last laugh there.
Yeah.
But yeah, there's a lot of stuff about Burroughs and his past that you just, well, I tend to forget about all the time.
Yeah.
just like the ministry phase and stuff, and him hanging out with Al Jurgensen all the time. And it's like,
yeah,
that's an odd pair.
Yeah.
I think there's probably also a lot of stuff about the Burrow story that's probably best to kind of forget. Oh, right. He killed his wife. Oops. Right. <know? laughs>
Yeah.
It was pretty funny because, I mean, he would buy a lot of books at our store, but he was also like, he came to our store. We had to make sure we carried Cat Fancy magazine. We had to make sure we held his copy of Cat Fancy magazine. Otherwise, he might not ever show up anymore, you know?
Wow.
And then also gun magazines. He was gun magazines and Cat Fancy. Like, he was the only customer where that Venn diagram came together, I think.
Probably the only one ever. Yeah.
I don't know. It's the Midwest, man. A lot of people like guns and cats.
That's true. Andy Padlin talked about being friends with Ted Nugent, and he actually likes cats.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. We found out that he just doesn't like feral cats. There's the difference.
Oh, yes.
I see.
We know he likes guns.
Right.
Right.
So he might be the same.
All right.
See, I always kind of thought of Ted Nugent as a feral cat. So this is really, this is kind of confusing to me.
Yeah. Well, I think the kind of the same problem exists with feral cats and house cats is you can't really ID them or profile them. Mm-hmm. But the right loves to do that. And, it's an interesting argument to make, you know. Hey, Ted, how do you know that cat has papers or doesn't? I think you're just assuming because it's a cat and it's outside.
Oh, that's amazing.
Right. A cat could have a house.
Well, the domesticated cats have the chips. And
and John, do you know the ice cream shop in downtown Columbia, Sparky's?
Sparky's, yes.
Oh, Sparky's is awesome. I lived in Columbia for, 8 years?
Uh-huh. Oh, no kidding.
Yeah, long time.
The owner of that is actually one of Christie's, best old friends.
Oh, okay. Scott, yeah.
Scott, yeah. Yeah, so they go way back.
Wow. Yeah. I want to steal paintings every time I go in there.
Oh, my God. Isn't it so much fun?
Yeah, it's great art in there.
Yeah, like all this kind of outsider amateur portraits that he's just been collecting forever. It's so cool.
And it's never for sale.
Nah.
Hey, that's the problem.
Yeah, no, he'll never sell them. He has no desire to sell them. You know?
Every once in a while, one will blow through and he's like, yeah, I'll sell that. You know, the artist just came through here or whatever. It's like, yeah, but it's not as good as that one, Scott. He's like, I know. That's why I'm not selling it. And those puppet, those stuffed animals he has, those little homemade nightmare looking crocheted stuffed animals that he has all.
Yeah.
Right. The concrete bulldog out front, the Sparky.
Yeah, right. That's and the ice cream's pretty good too. So it is. It's got a whole. The whole package.
Yeah.
Were you aware of the big crazy thing? Remember what was it? It's 10 years ago now when we had all the cicadas hit at the same time.
Yeah.
Oh, I think that's coming back around maybe even this summer.
I think so.
I heard it was coming back around and I think it might be this summer. But anyway,
So Sparky's made national news that year because they made fucking cicada ice cream.
That's right. Yep. Yeah, that's right. Mm-hmm. I'd forgotten about that. Amazing.
Yeah, he tried to tell everybody, he's like, look, these things are, extremely dried out. They're, all the gross parts are removed, everything. And they were put in an autoclave or something to sterilize them even. Mm-hmm. It's like, you can't even taste them. It was just kind of a novelty. Mm-hmm. And it was the same year, the 7 year and the 17 year cicadas came out. They were just everywhere.
Wow.
So it was just kind of a tribute to that. But people cracked down on them so bad just for that little novelty. They were going to shut them down.
Really?
Yeah.
Christy and I did a culinary vacation in Mexico once. And I didn't eat any. My excuse was because I'm vegetarian, but Christy was popping crickets like like popcorn.
Huh.
just these dried fried crickets. You'd be like, oh, okay.
Mm-hmm.
They'd be in the guacamole or whatever. It was amazing.
Right. Well, there's really not a lot to them.
Yeah.
I've tasted some. They're just seasoned and cooked. And it's they're just
salt.
All you taste is the seasoning. Yeah, the salt. They just taste salty, crunchy things.
And they're the protein source that supposedly could save humanity.
Right? Oh, yeah.
Which I think is incredibly cool.
Yeah. If Americans could just get over eating bugs.
Yeah.
That's all it is. But yeah, there'd be so much more we could do with that.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, they were one of the first ice cream joints around here too to start putting booze in ice cream. And that was controversial for Missouri at the time. Now booze and ice cream is just everywhere. You know, yeah, they had Guinness floats and stuff, and I thought that was great. But
yeah,
We have a lot of friends in Lawrence, too.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Friends and listeners in Kansas.
Like friends from early to mid 90s. Anybody that I might like still.
Yeah. Mark Hennessy. Do you know him? Or he's a pretty big reader, too. He's a poet. but he's the lead singer at that time. He would have been the lead singer of Paw.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Totally. Again, my memory's not super clear, but I remember meeting that dude
mm-hmm.
at least once. I mean, yeah, it was an exciting time to be there, too. Because, I mean, Vitreous Humor was still doing their thing, and you had Paw, and then there was like the big kind of Americana thing that was happening at right. the same time, and everyone's like t-shirt. It was just and I think if I remember correctly, I even played in a band there. We were called Black Lung, and we just played songs about coal mining. It was fun. I mean, it wasn't the kind of music I'd ever made before, ever really wanted to make. It was very bluegrassy and Americana, and I was actually playing just the snare drum with brushes, and I, you know, getting that train chugga 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 thing going on. That was like my entire job, and that and singing the high lonesome vocals in the background. But I mean, we could get gigs. That band in Lawrence, Kansas, at that time, could get a gig like at the drop of a hat. You know?
Yeah. I hope it's just as easy when they kick back up, you know, after this mess is over. But yeah, Mark, his newer band, well, he's in a few, but Godzillionaire.
It's so good.
We check them out. Yeah.
Oh, so I good. Should. Yeah. I don't think I knew about them.
It's better than Paw. And I really love Paw.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. Much more consummate of a sound. I would check them out. We'll send you a link.
Awesome. Thank you.
Check them out. But yeah, he's been, this happened too right at the break of the pandemic, but was picked as the new lead singer for Primitive Race, taking Chuck Mosley's old job in that.
No kidding. God, man, Chuck Mosley just can't hold a gig down, can he?
Well, he's dead.
Yeah, so that kind of hurts.
That's probably part of it. That's probably part of it. There you go. All right. But if we could edit that part out, my sad attempt at a joke, that would be fucking awesome. Thank you.
Right. He had a hard time before that, though.
That's for certain. Everybody instantly just went, who's this asshole?
Nah, I think there are probably people that don't know. There's a ton of people who don't know who the hell Chuck Mosley was.
It barely got on my radar when he died. It really did.
The only time I ever saw Faith No More was actually when Chuck Mosley was still in the band.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, yeah, the We Care A Lot era. Yeah. And they were great. I mean, just a mind-bogglingly great, fun show.
Yeah. We had Billy Gold on.
Yeah.
Oh, gosh, about a year ago.
Yeah, something like that. Yeah.
That's right. I saw that as I was trying to decide which episodes I'm going to listen to before I actually talk to you guys. Again, just the list is just astounding.
Well, I appreciate that.
We don't know how we do it, but yeah, thank you.
Yeah, we don't know either.
It's dumb luck.
Just very nice people who are willing to take a risk and, you know, and just be like, yeah, I'll do your show. I don't give a shit.
Mm-hmm.
We're amazed. I mean, but you don't know if you don't ask.
Yeah.
You know,
same guy that introduced us. It was, you know, a lead through Conan Neutron that got us Billy.
Mr. Conan?
Yeah.
Yeah, he's good at making those connections. He's like the impresario of Midwestern rock these days.
He is.
Oh, he really is. Yeah, yeah. We really feel blessed that we kind of stumbled into him, or he stumbled into us.
Yeah.
Yeah, just one of the hardest working dudes, too.
Oh, yeah.
The guy just is never off, you know. It's super impressive.
Yeah. And all the way to both coasts, and just the, you know, the bands he's played with, the bands he's endorsed, he's got to be going out of his mind not being able to play live right now.
Yeah, he'd been touring like crazy with the Secret Friends for a little while there.
Mm-hmm.
Speaking of which, the band I'm in, a band called Nonagon, you know, 2020 was going to be the year of Nonagon. We had scheduled like three small tours, and we had like, you know, we had this record in the can that we were going to be, you know, really excited about getting out and all of this stuff. And it was just like, well, the universe is telling us something here. It was a total bummer.
Yeah. Now the They Birds LP, that's the first LP you've recorded, if I've got it right, right?
First LP. Yeah. I mean, we had a string of EPs.
Right.
I mean, I don't know if you can call them a string if there's one every 5 years or whatever, but right. And then we did some split 7 inches with a couple folks, and that was it. So yeah, and we kind of thought we would always be the EP band,
right?
Like, you know, when we sat down to decide what we wanted to record, like, oh, well, you know, I guess we only have like five songs we're really excited about. Let's just do that, because, you know, recording songs you're not really excited about is like a waste of everybody's time and money. Right. So we just decided, you know, we sat down and we're like, hey, you know, I think we'd like to record again. And we looked at the songs we were excited about. And I'm like, oh my God, I think we actually have a record here. Like, a yeah. You
know, like, how did that happen? Yeah.
Still, it's very punk rock. I mean, hell, the Sex Pistols made a whole career out of that, you know?
Yeah.
Just doing EP after EP and really putting together, you know, one or two big albums. That's about it. Yeah. Heavily iconic rock band.
Yeah.
Another good example of somebody who, you know, weren't necessarily the greatest people, but made some good music. We were talking about earlier.
Yeah. Yeah. That's very true. And it's borne itself out to be true again and again and again.
Yeah.
With those guys.
Yeah.
I mean, especially that Sid Vicious. He's still around, right? He hasn't. He's like,
yeah. See, he's kind of an asshole.
How many other iconic rock stars I can proclaim living?
Yeah,
it's not a huge faux pas. I mean, Jesus, I'm even looking back at like the last year or two, and I guess we're kind of getting to that age to where, you know, people are just, they're going to start dying off, especially if they were your heroes and they're like 30 years older than you.
Yeah,
exactly.
And it's like, but I still run into people all the time like, oh yeah, he died.
Yeah.
He died just last year. And you don't, you know, you remember the big ones like Bowie. And
right.
Shit like that.
But I mean, you know, whenever anybody would die, like when Strummer died or, you know, whatever, there was always this like this huge outpouring. And, you know, and there are certain ones that I felt as a personal loss as well. I mean, Joe Strummer being one of them, just an incredibly important person in my life.
Sure.
You know, obviously somebody I've never met for more than 4 seconds, you know.
Right.
Just that creeping feeling that like, look, we're exactly what you said. We're in that zone where everybody's going to be kind of dropping off right now. Like everybody that's ever been, every hero you've ever had.
Yeah.
You know, this is the decade, you know, so.
Yeah.
So guard your heart a little bit, you know.
I'm going to bring that up with Eddie Van Halen next week.
Yeah. What's he doing?
I haven't heard much from him lately. I don't know.
Yeah.
Oh, God. This joke has officially made it impossible to cut my faux pas.
Exactly. You know? Too many callbacks. It's
officially baked in. Oh, my God.
Too many callbacks. No, you're fine. You're fine.
It'll be endearing.
Right. Most people don't even know who Chuck Mosley was, or that Faith No More had another singer, or that a lot of people don't know that Courtney Love also sang for four.
Yeah. She was in there for a little while.
Mm-hmm. Wait, what?
Yeah.
I did not know that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, friend of she was a friend of Roddy's, right?
I can't remember.
He's the keyboard player, right?
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Roddy, yeah, got it.
I think that's how she got into the band in the first place. Yeah, like Roddy was, I guess, with her, you know, during Kurt Cobain's death, and like was just like her confidant, I guess, through that whole thing. And I didn't know they were that close either, but yeah, it was something I just found out a couple of years ago, and I've been a Faith No More fan for years, is that Courtney was also a singer.
Yeah.
In Faith No More.
Oh, okay. Well,
I don't think I've ever heard any of the tracks, though. I just think I know that as a piece of trivia.
No, I do any of them. We should have asked about that.
Yeah.
Or maybe they just don't want to talk about it.
Yeah.
You could kind of almost tell when we were talking to Billy that, like, he was surprised that he found himself talking about Chuck.
Yeah.
Really? Mm-hmm. Just like a... like, oh, you guys are older than I thought kind of thing.
Now that's getting cut.
Yeah. It just kind of, you know, the way most shit goes on the podcast, it just kind of evolved there. And all of a sudden we're talking about it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think it started, you know, we were talking about Mark taking over that spot.
Yeah. Probably wrapped in the same conversation, a similar conversation.
Yeah. Something like that. But he was totally cool about it.
Yeah. But it's interesting, too, just the perspective, I think, when he was talking to us, that it, just being, like, in Missouri, and he was like, I'm surprised you guys even knew who we were. And it's like, dude, you're a multi-platinum.
Yeah.
Yeah. Pharaoh's the false modesty there, bud.
Yeah. Monsters Rock. But it was, I don't think it was really false.
No.
I think he was just, you know.
That's awesome.
He's been doing it for so long and just kind of in it for so long that he just kind of loses touch with the fact that yeah, he might have thought he was, you know, he certainly knows that he's not on the level of the Beatles or something like that, but he, you know, and that they're an alternative rock band, but still, You know, and you're just like, wow, I'm surprised anybody in the Midwest has even heard of us.
See, that to me, though, sounds and like, and I hope he's not listening because he's going to be like, who's this asshole? How many times are people going to say, who's this asshole? But that seems like a mid, that seems like a dig on the Midwest. Like, that seems like that could be read as, oh, didn't realize that you people knew who we were.
What do you mean, you people?
Exactly.
I think it's just being disconnected to a certain degree when you're, you know, if you're in that level of music and you've got handlers,
right,
and you got people who just who also just kind of push you out on tour and prepare a package for you.
Oh, I know. I know.
This is where you're going and like, this is who you were going to be. And then we'll see you in 6 months when you're back to reality and, you know, you come home and then, you know, you don't even know what you just did. You know,
you just, you know, you just told the whole Nonagon story. Like right there. Right.
Well, it was nice having you on, man.
Yeah, good to see you. We'll talk to you next week.
All right, cool. Later. Wait, who are you people?
Right. We'll see if that fits the narrative.
Yep.
But no, I mean, we've all seen that. I've seen plenty of bands who come through, especially in Missouri. And I don't think it's really a dig on the Midwest as much as, you know, just being like, hey, what's up, St. Louis? It's like, we're in Springfield, asshole.
Right. Yeah. Exactly.
Oh, man. You probably learned this one living here. It did not go over well if somebody was like playing a show on the Missouri side.
Oh.
And they'd say, oh, we never played in Kansas. People are just like, still not, asshole.
Yeah. Yeah. No, those border things, those border disputes are serious. Like, I think that the Twin City thing, the St. Paul, Minneapolis thing, I mean, that's been a rift since, you know, the Huskers and the Mats, you know, it's
right,
like,
yeah.
And it's really funny because, you know, we play with bands from both cities when we go up there, but never across the border.
Right.
You know, so like we'll play with like Self-Evident in Minneapolis, but, you know, but they rarely play with bands from St. Paul.
Mm-hmm.
It's still a thing somehow.
Yeah. It's odd. It's like one of the questions that I was even hesitant to ask. It's like just even in Chicago proper, it's like, are you a Cubs fan or are you a Sox fan? You know,
I was a Cubs fan for my entire life. And then when the current regime, one of the principal owners announced that, you know, with pride that he was the biggest fundraiser for Trump.
Yeah.
I dropped the cop with Cubs like a hot rock. It wasn't even hard. Mm. Like watching them and rooting for them, even though I still liked a couple of the players. I mean, Javi Baez, I mean, you got, you know, whatever, you got to love the dude.
Oh, yeah.
But I would watch those games and I would just feel icky.
Yeah.
So I instantly became a Sox and a Brewers fan, and it wasn't even hard.
Yeah. Well, and the way I'm kind of looking at it, too, is just that we got our you know, World Series win in 16 and probably be another 100 years.
Yeah. So, but I mean, I was at game 5, which was the last one to be played at Wrigley, because everybody thought they were out. They were done.
Uh-huh.
And so tickets that the day before, standing room only tickets that the day before were like $1,200, $1,300,
right,
were only $600.
Oh, wow.
And I was like, you know, I'm not a wealthy person, but I, you know, psyched myself into buying one for myself.
History.
And just, you know,
yeah.
And I didn't drink a single beer the entire time because it was standing room only. And I found my spot.
Because you were broke.
And I just, well, that's right. Exactly. All the beer money I just got. But yeah, no, I just didn't want to have to go pee.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. That makes sense.
I found my spot and I stayed there. I got there when the gates opened and I stood in one spot for like 5 hours, you know?
Yeah.
And, you know, really glad I did.
I think being a fan of any Chicago sports team, you know, when they win a championship or anything else like that, you always step back and you think, no, why am I a fan? And I mean, I'm sure it's that way everywhere else across the country, but so many things like family politics and, you know, where you live or where you grew up, or, you know, a drunk uncle yelling at you when you're 11. You're like, that's why.
Yeah.
You have to dig up like past traumas and things.
Yeah, it's all baked in to fandom.
But yeah.
Trauma's always part of it.
I've only been to Wrigley once, and it wasn't like a big game or anything, but it was when Sosa and McGuire were having the big home run battle. And Sammy hit 3 home runs while I was there. So I thought that was pretty cool.
Oh, that's pretty exciting.
That I at least got to see that. If that was like my only experience at Wrigley, that's a pretty good one.
That's a really good one.
course, he was juiced up.
Wait, he was? No, sorry, he was. He totally was. But I mean that, you know, I collect baseball stadiums. Mm-hmm. And like, you know, every time I go to a new stadium, I buy myself the fitted home cap and I score the game and the whole thing. So I've been to a ton, and I hate to say it, you know, given my, you know, having revoked my fan card, but Wrigley is still just absolutely my favorite place to see a baseball game. No question. Yeah.
It's an interesting atmosphere for sure.
Beautiful park. And I've always thought one thing that's weird about it that I've been trying to piece together an analogy for years is just the fact that a ball can get lost in the ivy.
I know. So great.
You can call it a home run or call it a foul or call it whatever. Just the fact that it can get lost in the bushes. And Chicago's like, oh, well, that one's gone. It's like,
yeah,
you're going to make that rule for one park. You know,
but there are like, what are they called? I'm sorry. There's a specific term for the rules that, you know, I mean, like the green monster,
right?
If it bounces off that part, you can play it. If it bounces off that part, you can't, you know, or whatever. They all have their little weird home rules. I remember when Minute Maid Park in Houston, I think they removed it, but there was a flagpole in the middle of the outfield for a little while.
That's right. Yeah.
Like there was that little embankment right by the back wall, right by the outfield wall. And then there was a flagpole that was actually in play. And I could never figure out how the center fielder didn't like rack himself.
It's one thing I always thought was funny about the NFL when they started those cameras on the, you know, on the wires that ran across fields.
Yeah.
Like one of these days, football's going to hit that thing. And what are they going to do?
Totally.
And I looked it up, and basically the NFL's rule now is if that ever does happen and it hits the wire or hits the camera, it's just do over.
Yeah.
Wow.
It's like, man, that could be a very important play.
Yeah.
That's, you know, what they've sacrificed for TV and everything else to be able to do that. It's like wild.
Yeah.
Wow. What was it? I was here like in Dallas when they opened the big new stadium there, and they have like the ginormous screens that are over the center of the field. Like kickers just have the best time trying to hit that.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I like taking golf swings at a cart.
Exactly.
With somebody at a driving range. That's funny.
Man, this is the best sports talk radio show I've ever been on.
I know, right?
It is. Don't worry, I'm going to run out real fast.
Oh, yeah, no, I'm not wired that way either. I think we've about exhausted my knowledge of all things sports ball.
We're getting close on me.
Kauffman Stadium here is kind of interesting because it's got the fountains behind the field.
Yeah.
And you know what's crazy? Even when I was living out there, I never made it to a game there.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I was running my own business. And so it was like 16-hour days and no time for baseball.
Yeah.
For like, you know, three straight or I guess it was closer to two straight years.
It's a nice little park.
Yeah. Yeah, I like it there. But yeah, so you guys, as far as Chicago goes, did you grow up there? Do you like live in the city? Or I know you guys like practice around Logan Square. Is that right?
Yeah, and that's where my house is. That's where Christy and I, we bought a house there back in 2000.
Okay.
Which we would never be able to afford now.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, yeah, the place has been gentrified to within an ounce of its life. Yeah, but Tony actually lives in Uptown. Tony Imani, the drummer.
Mm-hmm.
Robert lives in, I think it's called Mayfair, Avondale, whatever, you know, one of those neighborhoods that's close by. But yeah, we're all longtime Chicago folks, you know, went to school in state. I met Robert for the first time down at University of Illinois in Champaign.
Oh, okay.
He was an art major, actually, and he's the one who designed everything for the current record. And we were both kind of bouncing around in bands at the time back then. And Tony went to school in Carbondale, where John, you grew up in Illinois as well, right?
Yep.
So did you know the Blue Meanies? Do you remember?
Yeah, a little bit. I never got to see them or anything, but yeah.
Yeah, I mean, you know, they were a really big band at the time, and Tony was actually a founding member and longtime member of that band.
Oh.
So he's like, he toured Europe with them and the whole thing, yeah.
Right on. They were, well, I mean, they weren't before my time, but they were before the time that I was able to, like, go out and see shows without,
right.
You know, my parents busting my ass.
Right.
But yeah, yeah. Definitely Blue Meanies. And Matt, your uncle owned a building in Logan Square.
Yeah, he lived in Logan Square on Diversity.
Yeah.
Diversity, what building did he own there?
He owned a lot of property in Chicago, actually. We'll go back to the Cubs for a second.
Mm-hmm.
He was older. died several years back, but he owned one of the buildings that was around Wrigley that you could kind of watch the games.
Oh, like one of the ones that now has like the corporate boxes on the rooftop, like that kind of thing?
Right. Mm-hmm. He owned one of those buildings for a while, and I wish he'd have held that one.
Yeah.
he owned apartment buildings, basically.
Got it.
But he personally lived, you know, where it was a 76 station on Diversey. It might be something else now, but it was like a little gas station there, really small gas station.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know if I might not still be there. I don't know.
It might not. I haven't been there in probably 15 years.
It's changed so much.
Yeah.
The whole city's changed so much.
Yeah, it really has.
It wasn't too far of a walk to the subway from there.
Mm-hmm.
I remember that.
Yeah.
He built his own recording studio there, too.
Wait, what?
Yeah, it was really fascinating. Yeah. He was a fascinating guy.
He was. What was his last name?
His last name was Talbert.
Talbert. John Talbert.
Really very quiet guy. You would not have known that he owned like tons of property around Chicago.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
He would hang up his clothes in his front room. He had like a line strung through his house,
mm-hmm,
because it was a waste of money to use a dryer. But he was like a depression baby.
Right. Very frugal.
So.
Oh, wow. Wow. So what kind of music would happen in the studio that he built there?
He liked to write music, and it was just kind of poppy.
Huh.
I guess for that time, and mm-hmm, he had a few stories of interesting people that would come through. I'm trying to remember any particular names, but a few Chicago artists that kind of did all right locally that he was close to, and he was just kind of a lifelong. That was the only thing he spent money on, was like,
that's amazing.
His studio,
his music,
and he built it all by hand, and he had his reel-to-reels in there were like set to like this very weird speed, so basically nobody could steal his shit. If somebody like took one of his tapes, they wouldn't be able to get the right speed for it.
Booby traps. Yep.
This sounds like a character. This dude sounds amazing.
He was.
He was really fun.
I met him a couple of times. You know, very straight-laced, conservative guy, though, and really, you know, buttoned down. And if anybody's wondering, no, Matt is not, like, sitting on a giant trust fund.
No.
Matt's inheritance as a result of this real estate mogul is, what was it, two Telefunken microphones?
No.
Well, the family got those.
The family got them, yeah.
That was a pretty interesting story, too. So, yeah, it kind of fell on me because I was the closest one that knew anything about anything with studios or recording equipment. Still vastly underqualified for that task.
Mm-hmm.
But somebody had to, like, disassemble the studios.
Right.
So it kind of fell on me, and it was just, like, this heartbreaking experience to do. But it was also, like, it was weird because... like, it helped me know, like, what questions I wish I could have asked him,
mm-hmm,
you know, it was just going through that entire process. But
right,
he had some really cool shit in there.
Wow.
But the best that he had was two just pristine Elam, Telefunken Elam 251s, which are just, like, super valuable.
Oh, yeah, stupid rare.
Wow.
And we actually, he kept them in such good shape. And what was really interesting was that he kept all the paperwork for, like, everything he kept paperwork for. So he had, like, the original readouts for it. So at the time, Telefunken USA, they were trying to remanufacture, right? They had kind of bought the name Telefunken for the U.S. and they were trying to really get Telefunken's down. And this was like the only one they had ever found that had the original readouts of its performance when it was first made.
Wow.
So from like a reverse engineering point of view, it's invaluable to have something like that.
Yeah.
So a lot of the ones that they're making now are modeled in part after my uncle's microphone.
Yep.
That's amazing. Did you tell this story to Steve Albini when you had him on?
I don't remember if we did.
That's the next one on my list to listen to. But but he would go crazy for that story, I assume. Like, you know.
Well, one thing that happened with that will kind of tie it to Steve was we're friends with Rob Botchnik, who's also in Chicago, and he plays for like Glenn Hansard and the Frames.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Awesome guy, but he also kind of got his start working for Steve,
mm-hmm,
helped build the studio that he has now.
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah. I've got so many friends who have that story. Like so many friends. I mean, like literal punk rock blood, sweat, and tears went into the building of that place.
Yeah. Well, that's where you recorded your LP too, right?
Yeah.
The electrical audio. Yeah.
Yeah, it is. We worked with John Sampaolo there, who has been, you know, there since, I think he was one of the first crew of interns there when he was a younger gentleman, but now he's like, you know, full on one of the house engineers. Mm-hmm. And just working with him was just amazing. Just amazing.
So Rob bought a bunch of my uncle's microphones.
Oh.
Yeah, that's where the connection was made, right? You know?
Yeah. And that was like meaningful to me because I knew I wasn't going to be able to really use those things in a proper way.
Yeah.
But what they're going to get used really. And he has been using them. And on top of that, you know, they got to stay in Chicago, basically. Mm.
That's cool. That's really cool.
Yeah, it is. You got any Steve stories?
Actually,
you want to share? We just talked to Jason Thompson a couple of days ago. He had some.
You know, not really. I mean, Steve, like the first time I met Steve, you know, I was a huge Big Black fan.
Yeah.
In high school and in college. And then his unfortunately named band,
Rape Man,
which I thought was an even better band, was just insane. Like that two Nuns in a Pack Mule is just a perfect fucking record.
Great band. Extraordinarily bad name, but a great band.
We had an entire discussion about that once that will never see the air, and we're not going to talk about who it was where they got dark.
Nope.
Yeah, no, there's no way, anyway. There's nowhere for that discussion to go. I mean,
it's not a good one.
Yeah. And, you know, over the years, I've become pretty good friends with Bob Weston and all this stuff, but Steve, for me, was always like a super tough nut to crack. And the very first time I met him when I was in college, like I met him at a pool hall. He won't remember this at all.
No.
But, you know, I made him laugh. Mm-hmm. Right. And so I think I've been spending my entire life chasing that moment.
There's the dragon.
It has not happened since.
Yeah.
In fact, I spent, and it's funny, we're talking about baseball because, you know, he's a baseball fan as well. And so I went to a game at Wrigley with a couple friends. It was me and Jim Camp from the Chicago band Hungry Man. If you don't know them, they're absolutely incredible. A couple other friends. And then it was also Steve and Bob Weston were there. And I sat next to Steve the entire game. And I think only like four words were exchanged.
Right.
So I was probably giving off like a super like weirdo, like nerdy, like needy vibe or something. Yeah. I don't know.
Well, I was wondering about that too. Just like when we had him on, it's just like, I wonder how, because I felt the same way. I was just nervous as shit.
Yeah.
And like, it's like, my God, this is like one of my heroes as far as audio engineering is concerned and mixing bands and everything. It's like, can't believe we were talking about this just a few days ago with Jason Thompson. It's like, he's a notorious podcast whore is what he told us. You know, he's like, I'll do any podcast. I don't care. I think they're great. I don't know you guys. I don't know you from anything, but I'll do your show.
That's awesome.
And, yeah. Well, it helped us that we like threw Rob's name out and he's like, any friend of Rob's.
Yeah. But I kept wondering that like the whole time, like how much of this guy's life is just like people around him being extremely nervous.
Yeah. You know? Well, I mean, you know, don't get me wrong. He is like one of the most stand up, as you know, like we're just one of the most stand up, righteous, like right thinking dudes on earth.
Down to earth. Yeah.
I hate that he has like that reputation for being like just a prickly, like shit stirrer. You know, because that's just not him. He's opinionated. Not, you know, he's super opinionated, but, you know, almost everything that comes out of his mouth is like, that is dead on. You're absolutely right about that, you know?
Right.
So that's why it pains me to say that I couldn't get him to talk to me during an entire baseball game, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. I think one of the biggest things is like having a spark of life and talking to him in that interview was just bringing up the art of Ed Paschke. And he was like, ooh, and it perked his ears a little, you know, and he was like, oh yeah, I love Ed. And I study under Ed and I'm a big Ed Paschke fan of his art anyway. Mm-hmm. We talked about that for a while. And I was like, ooh, I brought up something that actually made him move in his seat for a second,
right?
You know, and smile. And I was like, oh, wow.
Yeah. And if you're anything like me, you're going to be chasing that for the next 25 years.
Yeah. Oh yeah. I always will be. Yeah.
Well, we kind of even told ourselves before we did that, we're like, well, I love the Pixies. I love Nirvana. It's been there. Everybody's been there with them.
Mm-hmm. Right.
What's the point? Why would I want to go there again?
Right.
Yeah.
So, well, I'm dying to listen to that interview because, you know.
It sounds terrible.
Oh, no.
Well, that kind of adds to it now in retrospect.
He's never going to know. And usually we cut this out, but I'm just going to bring up the story. He had a fan in the back of his microphone or in the back of his computer that was like clicking the whole time. And he even told us before we started, he's like, yeah, I can't get this fan to stop. I don't know. I don't know what's wrong with it, but fuck it, let's go ahead. Uh-huh. We're like, okay. Thinking, it sounds like garbage. That's and hilarious. Magic kept thinking, it's like, this guy is like one of the most premier like audiophiles in the world and doesn't give a shit that this fan is just destroying the sound.
I love that so much.
And like the format that we used was like, it wasn't what we normally use at all.
No, I think we did it on, what do we do it on?
It was like Skype.
Skype, yeah. We used to never use
Skype. Not good for sound quality.
Yeah.
If you're looking to get to, that's not the place to go. So yeah. We did it on Skype. And I remember like before it, I was like, oh my God, because I'm the one that edits these. And I was like, oh. Shit.
Oh, it's gonna be hard.
I'm gonna be editing for something for like this world renowned sound engineer. So really kind of ultimately it kind of took the pressure off.
Yeah.
Right. Because after a while you're like, fuck it. It's like the Zapruder film of all of our podcasts. That's extremely shit quality, but it's such an important subject that we had to put it up.
Yeah, totally.
You know? Like the Kennedy assassination.
Part of me wonders if Steve was even like did it on purpose just to take you guys off the hook, you know? Like
it's possible. Who knows how a mind like that thinks.
Yeah.
But so what are some of the joints you played around Chicago back when like music was a thing that you could do? What were some of your favorite venues and stuff?
Well, you know, our favorite venue was actually a place called Quenchers, which was at Fullerton and Western. And it was just, it was our home base. Like the folks that booked the place knew and loved us. And we could get, you know, with a couple months notice, we could get a weekend like slot there that we could build, you know, like, hey, we've got so-and-so coming through from Minneapolis, or we want to bring somebody down from Milwaukee. Can you give us a night? You know, we got to the point where they would say, yeah, you know, Thursday, Friday, or Saturday. And we'd be like, really? You know, and take it. And it was just such a comfortable place to play. And it was kind of our Natchez, Kansas City or whatever, you know.
Right.
But they, you know, the neighborhood continued to gentrify and they ended up closing years ago. You know, we used to play the Bottle every once in a while, but there's a whole story there that it's not my story to tell, but there's a Shellac song called Boycott that's all about the empty bottle. And that's, it's worth, you know, it's an interesting thing here. But not even a lot of people in the Chicago scene know the whole story. So, but so we don't play there anymore. But you know, the Bottom Lounge. There's a there are always places kind of opening and closing in Logan Square. You know, Cafe Mustache, Township, like all these. You know, Kohl's, like all these kind of small places that we could generally get a show. You know, and we were never kind of the band that was like tapped to open up for. Hey, Arches of Loaf is coming through town. Although actually we were tapped for that once and we couldn't do it, much to our shame. But, but hey, somebody's coming through town. You're the band we'd like to have open. That almost never happens to us. We generally are the band because of the music community that we're all part of. That's actually, you know, based on the Electrical Audio Forum.
Right.
We're the band who, because we could get a show at Quenchers or because we could get a show at Township, where the out-of-town PRF bands would say, hey, we want to come to Chicago. Can you help us set up a show?
Oh.
And like 90% of our shows were those shows.
Nice.
And, you know, we wouldn't trade it for the world, you know, but it does mean that, you know, we're playing for the same 10 to 100 people all the time, you know?
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Yeah.
Sounds like our podcast.
Yeah. I think some of our biggest fans are everybody who's been on.
Yeah, well, you know? I'm sold. I mean, this is a really smart way to build your fan base, I think.
Yeah. To build it, yes. To market it, no.
It's a really slow way to do it. I can tell you that.
I think that's the way it goes with anything. It's like, it's a musician's musician. It's an artist's artist. Well, yeah. It's like, yeah, but you need to sell more shit. So We need everybody.
Yeah,
but it's not why you do it, you know. So
that's right.
You know, I mean, if this had been a business, we would not have lasted as long as we have. You know,
right?
Yeah. That's true. That's what we keep telling ourselves.
Yeah.
I feel more sane doing it than before we started doing it. So
that's priceless.
Oh yeah. Especially with what's been going on in the past year.
Oh man, I really don't know how I'd deal with a pandemic if I didn't have this outlet.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm jealous of that, actually. You know, I mean, I have my stuff kind of set up and I can play anytime I want, but that doesn't mean that I'm able to, or I'm in the right mindset. Like, you know, I'm sure you've heard this over and over again from musicians who have like been weathering this thing where it's for the longest time, until pretty recently, almost all of the people that I know were like, I just can't motivate myself to get anything done. Just can't motivate to get anything done.
It's gone both ways.
Yeah.
Some people really, it's kind of motivated them to do more.
Yeah.
And they entered like a prolific period.
Yeah. And I know some of those guys and I hate them. No, I'm kidding entirely. Yeah. I mean, we took it, hey, we can't practice. We can't be playing shows. We've got this record in the can. We've got this downtime. Like, let's focus our energy into getting this record out. And I don't think we would have done as good a job of it with any of it, like the packaging, the promotion, the, you know, just kind of the networking. I don't think we would have done any of it if without being stuck at home to do it. So
yeah,
right, you might still be with EPs.
Yeah, right, exactly. Exactly.
Well, it's another year, you know, just one more year, because shit.
No, but it gave us something to do that made us feel like we were still in a band, you know.
Yeah.
No, that makes sense.
Yeah.
So you talked about it, and I kind of lost my place on this, but with the artwork on the LP, which is great, by the way.
Yeah, Robert's a genius.
It's just such a funny album. So did he draw all that? Yeah. And did he? He did like all the figures of the the animals with the wings attached. It's hilarious.
He's an amazing illustrator. He's just, I mean, and you kind of forget he's kind of the quieter guy in the band.
Mm-hmm.
He's the kind of person who doesn't say much, but when he does say something, you want to listen because it's usually devastatingly understated.
Yeah.
Funny.
Yeah, yeah,
you know,
yeah.
It's just like the funniest, like most cutting thing you've heard, but he doesn't say that much. And so it's kind of easy to forget sometimes that, right, Robert's a genius. Like, kind of forgot, right, you know,
what's going on upstairs that he's not just talking about all the time. Yeah.
Right. Yeah, exactly. And his art is part of that. I mean, he does these giant woodcuts, you know, that are like the size of like a living room window. I mean, he's just a really, you know, he just spends a lot of time working on this stuff.
Mm-hmm. So kind of a chicken and the egg question. Was it the title of the album before it was the artwork, or was it?
Oh, yeah.
It was, actually. Yeah. Our records have a history of being named after goofy stuff that Tony has said, like in the van.
Mm-hmm.
And so like we had an EP out that was called People Live Everywhere. And it was just because we were after a show, we were like looking for a place to stay or whatever. And we were going through a neighborhood outside, I don't know, in Pittsburgh or something.
Mm-hmm.
And he just went, man, people live everywhere. And just like, it just destroyed us for some reason. You know, that like late night, like hilarity thing, you know?
Right.
Getting slap happy.
They Birds was a very similar moment.
Uh-huh.
We were traveling in the Upper Peninsula to go to a PRF event up there, my favorite one, Thundersnow.
Mm-hmm.
And it's February when this thing happens in Upper Peninsula, mm-hmm. like all the rivers are frozen.
Right.
Except in this one spot where there's a dam that keeps the water churning, so the water isn't frozen there. And it reminded me actually of the dam in Lawrence, Kansas, where you used to be able to go in the middle of winter and watch all the bald eagles from the area would hang out at the dam in Lawrence, Kansas. And I was totally like probably over explaining this in the van to the guys. And you know, one of them asked, well, why do they all hang out there? And I said, well, you know, they fish. Tony just looked at me and said, nuh-uh. They birds.
and that,
of course, just sent us on like a laughing jag that lasted for the rest of the tour, probably, you know?
Right.
Awesome.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure I know the dam you're talking about, too.
In Lawrence, the one right downtown.
Yeah.
Yeah. by the old mall there. Yeah.
Yeah. It seemed like some sort of in joke. Like, even if you don't know the in joke, look at the cover and it's funny.
Yeah. I think there was an effort to like kind of make it somehow translate to, so people wouldn't just think, oh, they're entertaining themselves at the expense of the rest of us, you know?
Hi. Yeah, I kind of got it. But yeah, the artwork is just incredible. It's all the, and I don't even want to describe it. Just go check it out.
Fish and lemurs and
fish and lemurs. Yeah, shit like that. That's great.
Oh, yeah.
I really want to frame that record and put it on my wall. It's just so funny.
Oh, that's nice. Thank you.
Gives me a giggle every time I see it.
I think it offsets like some of the darkness of the record itself, which helps.
Yeah. It's still a fun record, man. I mean, it really is. It's like, I'd love to see it translated live.
Yeah, we actually just recorded like a virtual record release show that nobody's going to accuse us of being tour tight when they see this thing.
Right.
But Tony actually works in a warehouse. So we've started kind of practicing, dipping our toes into practicing in this big, wide open indoor space with our masks on, like 20 feet away and the whole thing. And so we decided to try and make that translate to a to a record release show that I think we're going to try and stream live in like mid-April.
Right on.
Yeah, it was fun. It was really fun to put together. Again, it's not going to be the tightest we've ever sounded or anything, but I think we've done enough kind of fun stuff in the presentation of the show that it should be an entertaining thing to watch at least.
Yeah.
But thanks for what you said. I mean, yeah, the record has some bombast and some energy to it that we're really proud of. So I'm really glad that you, I mean, you know, even though the songs are sometimes about, well, at least two of them are about aging gracelessly. So.
Right.
I think one review on Bandcamp, I think from a fan, said something like mortgage rock.
Oh yeah.
Which.
First time I heard that term, my friend Jay Ryan, who's in, he used to be in a band called Dianoga, but he's also like a well-respected, you know, gig poster artist. Mm-hmm. He used to refer to his band Dianoga as mortgage rock, and that was the first time I'd heard that. And I think
awesome.
I think it's become like a Chicago thing.
That'd be a good label name too.
Yeah, yeah.
Mortgage rock. Yeah, that would be fantastic.
Yeah,
mortgage rock record.
Like a web. Sorry, I was saying I was going to go off on a yacht rock like tangent there. Never mind. Never mind. I don't think I got it. I don't think it's there. It was so close. I just couldn't grab it.
It's out there. You can message me about midnight and be like, I remember.
Fire up the bikes. We're going to do this.
Let's cut that in there. You guys have any plans for like what the, as far as your next, beyond that show, as far as your other recordings go or other mixings?
Well, you know, it's been really exciting to start playing again, you know, in that warehouse because we actually have started writing. Because I'm, you know, the wood shedding I've been doing has resulted in a bunch of parts that need to somehow be strung together. And that's my mm-hmm. favorite part of any of this, right, frankly, is writing songs with these two people who take all of my terrible ideas and fix them. And so that has been really great. So we have been writing. I think we probably have, we're well on our way to having our next like three or four songs.
Excellent.
To the point where we might, a big part of our writing process is to fail in public. So we have these to the point where we'll try and play them in front of people, even though we don't have lyrics yet, or, you know, I'll be like susudioing over the entire thing. And
right.
Because I think it's really that tells us not necessarily even crowd reaction, but just our comfort level with the songs, you know, like what it really does make a difference to us to have to play them live. You know, it's that adage of like one live show is worth like 10 practices. And I think it's completely true. Which is why we tend to practice during our live shows. So,
right.
Yeah.
As far as like setting, I mean, I think we're still a ways from setting up, like thinking about club shows or whatever.
Right.
You know, I mean, I got my first Moderna last week, and you know, my second shot's coming up.
Congratulations.
Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah, it did make it seem like the light at the end of the tunnel, you know, might not be a train coming at you, you know?
Yeah, it does.
And it did make it seem like the world may be possible again at some point. But, you know, I don't want to be the band that set up a show that got a dozen people in the hospital. You know what I'm saying?
Right. I don't think anybody wants to be that cat.
No.
Well, yeah, I talked to Ted Nugent. I bet he begs to differ.
Right. Oh, they're feral. They'll survive. Yeah, it's weird. It's weird kind of how that was. And I don't even think I felt ready. Like, I just got my my second Moderna. I just got my final shot on Thursday. I think it was Thursday night.
Yeah, it was Thursday.
Yeah. So it's been a couple of days. It's even just a couple of weeks. But like, my youngest daughter, she's over the pandemic.
Yeah.
She's just like, you know, all right, let's get out. It's like, no, it doesn't work like that, honey. You know, you have to wait. But I am starting to have to face these things that it's like, okay, you know, here in a couple of weeks, I will be. And really, after that first shot, you're covered by about 70% within a couple of weeks after taking that. But it's like, oh my God, it's like almost... It's almost been something to blame.
Are you starting to feel like a little anxiety about re-entering social situations?
Yeah.
I am. Yeah. I guess that's what it's leading to, is just that kind of apprehension. It's like, ooh, how do I do, you know, public anymore? And how do I, you know, and you still got other people we have to wait on to get vaccinated. But I think one of the biggest things, and usually because I'm kind of a cynic and a bitch anyway, is that I've been looking at it like, I hate seeing people online, you know, explaining themselves or apologizing for being vaccinated.
Right.
And they're like, oh, you know, well, oh, I got both vaccines, but I'm a healthcare worker, but I'm sick.
Right. You're afraid of looking greedy or.
Yeah.
Right.
So the point, we want everybody to get it. I want everybody to get it.
Exactly.
And really the thing is, it's like you want to tell people too that you're doing it for them. So instead of saying, oh, I got my second shot, I'm a healthcare worker, you should say, I got my second shot, you're welcome.
Yeah.
You know, because we're doing it for everyone, you know.
Yeah. I have a friend who, you know, she's getting radiation for cancer and she's going into the clinic a lot. And she even felt guilty about getting her vaccination because she's like, well, I'm younger than a lot of other people. I'm like, you're going into this clinic with all of these people, all the other patients there have, you know, they're, you know, compromised immunity and all of this stuff.
Mm-hmm.
You should be, you know, taking all of the needles and shoving them in all of your limbs. You know,
right.
You shouldn't feel bad about any of this.
Right.
And people should be thanking you for taking it. Because, I mean, really, all in all, the CDC, everybody else has told us that the best way we're going to get past this is everybody can vaccinate. Everybody can get over that.
Yeah.
You know, and that's just kind of the way I look at it. I tell people, thank you.
Yeah.
You know, thank you for getting it. One more person.
I like that.
Because I was in a situation here in Missouri where they, like, you know, they ran out of vaccines for my tier, and my tier was open. And it was like 3 weeks past when I probably could have gotten a shot.
Mm-hmm.
And eventually they came around. But that's what I started to do. The moment I got it, I was just like apologizing.
Yeah.
And I'm like, dude, that's it. You know, I can't believe that people have put us into that situation.
Yeah.
To make us feel like we should feel sorry for what we've done.
Yeah.
Really, we're everybody who gets a shot, either first shot, second shot, even willing to do the shot, is helping everybody else in this country.
Yeah. And the thing is that, like everything else, you know, it's so politicized. And I know you know this.
Yeah.
That a friend, my friend Ike, who is in the amazing Kalamazoo band called Minutes, and Out, two just insanely great bands.
Mm-hmm.
But he said that a friend of his had gone to his doctor or her doctor.
Mm-hmm.
And the doctor said, you know, get your vaccine as soon as you can. And she said, well, I've been trying to, I just can't get an appointment. And her doctor flat out said, get a political map, find the reddest county nearby, drive there. You'll have no trouble.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's telling.
Yeah, it was exactly true. And like in Chicago, so many of my friends have driven downstate to Quincy.
Yeah.
Because apparently you can get the Johnson & Johnson one and done.
Mm-hmm.
Just walking into any drugstore without an appointment because nobody else is getting them down there.
Mm. Wow, that's crazy.
Missouri, I think there was a distribution issue. Like, it's almost the opposite here.
It was at first.
Like, Kansas City was getting them way before the rest of the state.
Hmm.
Maybe St. Louis was too, but like, Columbia was left out. John was like, when the fuck is it going to come here? And I'm like, I don't know. I just had mine.
Yeah.
Hmm.
My wife had hers a couple of weeks before that.
Hmm.
Yeah. But I mean, distribution has, been a big problem too. Just not politicizing, but looking across the entire world. Like I say, we talked to Jason Dobson a few days ago, and from Little Teeth, and he was lived there in Chicago for a while, moved to Munich. He's like, it's just a really super low number of people being vaccinated. It's not because of politicization. It's because they're just not. They're trying to get everybody in the EU basically vaccinated first. And it's a big number of people there. So, you know,
he brought up an interesting thing though, that I thought kind of tying into what we were talking about, just what it's going to be like to be able to hug someone that's not like your spouse.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Just walk up to people and shake their hand or whatever.
I hadn't really even considered that. And I got goosebumps thinking about being able to give someone a hug. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I've been a big hugger. And so, like, you know,
yeah,
that physical closeness to me is like, you know, I didn't realize how big a part it was of many of my friendships, you know, and it's a bummer. And I don't know how quickly I'll be able to as much as I want to.
Yeah.
I have a lot of anxiety about this still. And it's not anxiety for myself. It's anxiety that I'm going to somehow be spreading this thing.
Right. Or making other people anxious and making them nervous.
Yeah. Right. Exactly. Yeah. There's that whole like social contract thing too, you know?
Yeah. It's weird. And I wonder how many things are going to change just indefinitely, looking at things like schools where they cut off all the water fountains in the school and just having kids refill water bottles. And it's like, you know, water fountains have always been kind of gross. Are we going to still do that? You know?
Yeah.
So much stuff. Yeah.
Should we at all? I mean, just with like the flu or just anything else, should we still all be drinking out of a communal tube?
It's a fair question.
You know, we know children are putting their mouth on, because I did when I was 5. You know?
Well, yeah. I also do think at the same time, kids that age get their germs all over everything.
Yeah. So how much should be allowed?
Right. So like the water fountain is part of it. It's just another thing that they're going to get their mouth juice all over, and then another one's going to lick it.
Sure.
Yeah. Well, I mean, and all those germs were keeping us, you know, in some ways safe for so long. I mean, I know that there are some like immunologists, probably said that wrong, who are kind of aghast at the amount of hand sanitizer we're all using.
Yeah.
Because, you know, all of our gut bacteria and all that stuff depends on, you know, a pretty unsanitary environment that we have all kind of grown used to, you know?
Yeah. My mother as a nurse said for years about superbugs, you know, way before this ever happened with MRSA and everything else, just like, you know, we're over sanitizing things. People need to, you know, that's how kids build immunity is just, you know, they're on the playground. They pick their nose. They, you know, put their hands down their pants. They climb the same monkey bars.
God, that was a disgusting description. I'm never going on monkey bars again. Good thing I'm north of 50, so it wasn't going to happen anyway, but you know what I'm saying.
Can you even find monkey bars anymore? I don't even know.
I don't know, actually. They probably have been deemed as deemed too dangerous, and to be fair, they probably always were.
But I loved that shit when I was a kid.
Of course, yeah.
Sure. I remember like the wild geometric domes that would be set up just to bars.
Yep. Yep, and good luck.
It was just
yeah.
Keeping dentists in business for, you know, all across the Midwest.
Right. Oh, you can hear that sound. You can feel that sound.
Wow.
I know. That was good. That was onomatopoetic.
Ooh, that's a good word. Oh, yeah.
I don't really see seesaws anymore either. Remember how that feel just coming up and slapping you in the ass if somebody did it too hard and like just going all the way up your spine? Wow. Again,
probably not good.
I remember being a fat kid and holding people hostage on that thing. like skinny kids who wanted to get on with me and like sitting in the end and ha ha, and you're stuck in the air. Help, let me down. No.
Down. Yeah. I'm going to need that Twinkie you got in your lunch.
It's going to cost you. It's going to cost you.
Talk about a sound. Here's one. Mm-hmm. The rubber like dodgeballs that boom.
Bing. Yeah.
Yeah.
Especially when you got stalked in the eye.
Yeah, holy, as it ricochets off of somebody's face. Yeah, totally.
Yeah, I see a lot of those memes. I can feel this sound, right? Or I can hear this sound without, you know, just an image.
Mm-hmm, totally.
Yeah, I wonder what this last year is going to sound like. I imagine that kind of squishy, icky sound that like a hand sanitizer bottle makes. That's in those little
keychain.
That kind of sound.
Yeah, that would be a really cool kind of
sample, maybe
thing to do. Like, yeah, just like the sound of a year.
Yeah,
I think it's going to be my wife's quiet seething.
Yeah,
no, we've actually weathered this thing really well, but
that's not as fun.
The cabin fever has been a thing on occasion.
Yeah, you know?
Right. It'll just be just a little.
Damn it. Exactly. Yeah, I got a lot of those tonight. Did you know that Sonny Chiba was a martial? Yeah.
Really?
Okay. Yeah. My daughter's going back and forth with that right now. She wants to know all my useless information about like kung fu movies and horror and everything while my wife sits in the background and sighs about everything. It'll be over soon. I think we're coming around.
We're closer.
Yeah.
We're getting closer.
Yeah. Every day we're closer, as long as everybody stays the course and nobody, you know, fucks it up too bad. You know, I'll be back on stage spitting on people soon.
Yes.
You know? So
yeah, I mean, we've got at least 60% of the population thinks it's a good idea. So that's a start.
Yeah.
And at a certain point, and again, this may seem callous, but at a certain point, it's like, if we get to the point where those folks still have decided that they're not going to do it, and the rest of us are at, you know, 70, 80, 90% immunity, or at the very least, we're pretty much guaranteed of not having to go to the hospital from this thing.
Right.
Then that's kind of, at a certain point, it's kind of on them. You know,
right.
Like we can't continue. We're going to get tired of protecting some of those folks.
Right.
For, you know, the indefinite future, you know, so.
Yeah, you're not wrong. I've been saying the same thing, and it's so hard to balance around because you don't want to say, well, fuck them, you know.
Yeah.
Right.
But to a certain degree, it's kind of like, you know, we did everything we could.
Yeah.
And yeah, it is going to get to a point, I think, where, you know, they're just going to be affected. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
And we're not.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, I already do have friends, and I won't name names, who have no kids, you know, who have nobody around them they have to worry about infecting, or older people, and they're just like, shit, I'm 2 weeks out of my second dose. Well, too bad for them.
Yeah.
I'm like, yeah, it's I get it, though. I mean, we've got a certain degree of empathy we have to still instill, and if we want to help people, but man, if you're making it so hard.
Yeah.
You know, after a certain point, it's like, it's too bad.
Oh, yeah. And just like the bullshit excuse. Like, I saw, and I know that they are thinking that this is, you know, God's way, whatever. But I saw, like, you know, God's intention, you know, you shouldn't have to worry about it. Like, when it's your time, and God will bring you home when, you know, Jesus says it's cool. And so why would I do this? And I'm like, I know that you protected your kid when they were little.
Sure.
You didn't just let them run into the middle of the highway.
Right.
And if it's God says it's time, it's time.
Yeah.
God will protect the kid if it's not his time.
Yeah.
Oh, you get your kid out of the highway. God.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
Well, I mean, all we can do is what we can do. Right.
Yeah.
We can analyze that, and who knows how it's going to go. There could be a COVID-21.
Yeah.
You know, it could be in some new variant that, you know, just so off the chain that they won't even protect us. We don't even know.
Yeah. But hopefully the boosters will be available as those arise, you know.
Right.
They're already working on those, you know, like the South African variant, you know, or whatever.
Yeah. And I hope they're working on for kids too. And that's, you know, it's a big thing for me and Matt having kids. I'm just making sure that they can get protected. And
yeah.
But, you know, if we can get that herd immunity up to a level where everybody else is vaccinated and protects our kids, that's good for me too.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Whatever, but all we can do is what we can do.
I want to get there.
You know, I feel bad about condemning anybody, but
I don't. I'm feeling less and less bad about calling them out.
Yeah,
because it's stupid. I literally had one tell me Biden's not paying me enough yet to do this. Basically, he's like holding out for cash to get his shot.
They're already giving you donuts, dude. I mean, you can go to Krispy Kreme; they'll give you a donut, get a sticker.
Really? I didn't hear about that.
Yep.
Yeah. All
right. That's good news.
Yeah. Get your vaccine. I think if you get both vaccines, you get a free donut a day for like a while if you go to Krispy Kreme.
I wish I lived a little closer to one then.
Yeah. Well, we don't have one here either, but I'd have to drive down to Springfield, Missouri.
Oh my God. This was like a awesome/horrible promotion mm-hmm. that they had at Krispy Kreme once. This was like, we'll go back to baseball. Mm-hmm. So they had like a deal when the Royals were playing one summer that like, I can't remember how often it happened, but like if the Royals were getting so many hits in a game,
right,
you could take your ticket from the game in for a free dozen Krispy Kreme.
Oh, shit.
Whoa.
Yeah.
And that summer, I went to like two or three games, and I swear every fucking time they got enough hits.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, American League,
man. Man, and I figured out by like the last time that that happened, I could also like skim the ground for people's dropped tickets.
Oh, right. Oh my God. Did you gain like 30 pounds?
Holy shit. It was probably a couple of years at least before I ate Krispy Kremes again after that. But I had like 5 boxes of Krispy Kremes.
What's for dinner, Dad? Donuts again.
This was way before that. My wife would not have allowed that to happen.
I'm sure the executives of Krispy Kreme are like, how many donuts can you really eat?
Oh my God.
It was just it was just a giant social experiment to see how many donuts Americans would eat if given unlimited donuts.
Right. Here's the board meeting. Oh, turns out a fucking lot.
Exactly.
Americans love donuts. Grossly underestimated.
Looking back, it's a miracle I survived that time. Holy shit.
Right. If we survived that, we can survive this, right? I mean, right. Come on.
Right. Might survive it as a diabetic, but oh, we lived.
Remember the Krispy Kreme siege.
One other thing I want to get in, man, getting your stuff, what's the best way to do it? Is Bandcamp still probably the best way to get a hold of anything?
Yeah.
Any exclusives through any other websites, anything else?
We do run a small label with our friends, the Austerity Program, another just astoundingly amazing band from Queens. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, I was going to bring them up because I was listening to them and I wanted to talk about just that whole label. And that was kind of interesting. So it's like a co-op type thing.
Yeah. I mean, it looks like a label, you know, it looks like a small indie boutique label. It's basically just, you know, us, Austerity Program, and a couple other like side projects, but it looks like a label, but it's run pretty much like, I don't even want to say co-op, it's more run like a commune, you know.
Right.
Uh-huh.
We all split the tasks, you know. Justin from the Austerity Program, he's really good with numbers and the legal stuff, so he takes care of all that. We have Robert, who handles all the web stuff, and then there's me. I'm not qualified to do anything technical at all, so I'm the warehouse, basically. I take all the, I ship everything out, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And Justin is also just an amazingly like kind of smart and organized taskmaster, so he has kept us on pace for getting this record out over the course of the year, you know, weekly Zoom calls, giving like, you know, okay, you all on your task, you all know what you need to do. It's been, we wouldn't have been able to do it without him.
Right on.
But Controlled Burn Records is the name of the label. And we do have a website, controlledburnrecords.com, and we have the store on there. And that's where you can get older stuff and t-shirts and check out some of the other projects on there. So that's a good place to go as well.
Yeah.
Okay, good. Yeah, I like to just give everybody the opportunity because sometimes people find it through different avenues and may not be the best avenue, or maybe an old, you know, merch site or something. And
yeah,
want to make sure we're steering people in the right direction to, you know, get the band as much promotion and as much money as they can make and everything else from that.
And I think it should be up on Spotify and Apple Music and all that stuff too. I mean, you know, so, you know, the download stuff, but as far as the physical stuff goes, I think you're pretty much limited to Bandcamp. And oh, well, actually, if you're in Europe, there's Throat Ruiner, which is a small distributor in France, has some copies. So if you don't want to deal with the overseas shipping, you can get some from them. I keep forgetting to plug that. because I keep on getting international orders through Bandcamp. I'm like, oh God, right. time to you know, spend $30 on shipping on a single record just to find out that maybe it never made it, you know?
That
reminds me of something I keep wanting to like kind of just mention real quickly. And it's not necessarily related to any of the, but we have like this really high number of listeners from the UK, but we never hear from them. So I'm like really kind of curious who these people are. Say hi. I think it's cool as hell, but say hi. I want to know who you are.
Probably has something to do with some of our UK guests, I would imagine. Or
there's also a strong UK PRF presence. So maybe some of them are, you know, like friends of Conan's or whatever, you know, or friends of mine.
There you go.
That could be.
I mean, having Leslie on and ranking of Ruby and things like that. We've got some
Scotland. Yeah.
Scotland, Ireland. We've got a lot of those guests over there. Yeah. So, yeah, it's kind of weird. Our fan base, just looking at countries, is like, it's only what, like 74% American. The rest of it's all over the world.
Wow.
Yeah, it's weird.
Yeah, we get listeners in Africa and everywhere else. Strange.
That's great.
Never heard from any of them, but of course they just could have clicked on the wrong link.
Who are these guys? I was trying to get a hold of. They did find out there's another Undetermined podcast recently.
Yes.
But they do like mysteries.
Yeah, kind of a like a murder podcast, one of those.
True crime kind of thing.
Yeah, true crime thing.
It's probably what it is. It's just looking for murder mysteries.
Are there ever any kind of like podcast scene beefs between like did you ever consider like, hey, we've been around longer than you, maybe you shouldn't call yourselves that?
It's considered, I guess, just in the fact that, you know, I could be a douchebag if I wanted to, but I'm not.
Yeah,
I encourage any and everybody to podcast as much. I know the market's getting saturated and flooded,
right?
But I am all about anybody doing this as much as they can, and I will encourage them and I will give them a thumbs up. You know, they can even rip me off to a certain degree. I'm cool with that as long as they are doing something.
Yeah.
I think it could be something fun to lean into.
That's really fun. I mean, we, you know, for a while, Google searches would bring up two different bands called Nonagon. Now I think it actually brings up sometimes like as many as two or three. But the first time we ran into it, it was kind of a laptop, you know, electronic artist out of San Francisco who went by the name Nonagon. And we kind of sent him a note like, hey, this is pretty fun. You know, like, hey, I really like your stuff.
Right.
And he wrote back, hey, we really like your stuff too. And we always like, you know, we're thinking, wouldn't it be great if we like toured together and, you know, and we're still kind of friends. We're still kind of friends with that guy, you know.
That would be hilarious.
Yeah.
That's cool. Yeah. I think more people are worried about it on the other end maybe than they would from us, but I mean I don't care. Yeah, I remember having that conversation. I think it was with Leslie Rankin talking about band names.
Yeah, like there was more than one Ruby.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And just like there's always going to be that, and it's like, you know, fuck it. After a while, I remember, I mean, when I was younger, that was the thing. Like if you, in the internet first popped out, it's like, if you ever find a band name that's got your same band name, you have to abandon that name immediately. Mm-hmm. You know, and there was like this, but there's so many people out there recording music right now.
Yeah.
You're going to run into it.
Yeah.
And now I guess you just look at it and say, how many downloads do they have?
And maybe I'll accidentally get some of their people to listen to us, you know.
Exactly.
Yeah. It's all good.
In the pre-internet days, I remember going to see a band that was playing, and I was thinking it was a completely different band, but they had the same name.
Oh.
And I was like super disappointed.
No, there used to be a band in Chicago. One of my favorite bands from the 90s was from Columbus, Ohio, called Scrawl. Mm-hmm. You know, they're one of those bands that would break up for a while and then every once in a while get back together and play a show. And
right.
I saw Scrawl was playing the hole in the wall club in Chicago. And this was back, you know, before the internet.
Mm-hmm.
Or before I had the internet. And so I called the club and I was like, oh my God, I just want to make sure before I come down there and see the show, is this the Scrawl from Columbus, Ohio? And the guy that picked up the phone goes, oh my God, I'm going to kill these guys. Like he was just, apparently he had been fielding calls like that for like a solid week because this local band decided to call themselves Scrawl, you know?
God damn, that's rough. Sorry to hear that. Kind of on the nose though, you know, you're gonna run into that.
Yeah.
Having a name that solidified, but just people, as long as it's sincere, you're not trying to rip anybody off,
right?
I never blame anybody.
Yeah.
There's only so many cool words,
right?
You're gonna run into that. So it's where the heart is. I think that's what's important. But yeah, you guys will always be my Nonagon.
Aw, that's really sweet.
Absolutely.
Thanks, John.
But yeah, we don't want to keep you on all night or anything, man. Anything else you want to plug or anything? Want to give you the opportunity besides just bullshit baseball talk?
This has been a blast.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
I feel like my bandmates are going to listen to this and be like, were you ever going to even try to talk about the band? But, you know.
Yeah, that's how it goes.
I'll take this all day. This was great. Thank you.
Anything else you want to plug for them, man, you think? Or it'll probably never be good enough.
Never.
Never be good.
You know, we've always been the band that was shy about promoting ourselves, really, to be quite frank about it. And, you know, I think that just kind of not being a dick is like kind of our best our best promotion.
Yeah.
So as long as like the Chuck Mosley fan club doesn't, you know, come with pitchforks, you know,
no.
I think I'm good.
They're not going to care. Yeah. No,
I bet you Chuck Mosley would think it was fucking funny.
I think he might actually. Yeah. Yeah.
All right. Yeah. We don't want to keep you on all night, but you know, come back on.
Absolutely.
Are you serious? I'd love to.
Yeah. Yeah.
What are you doing tomorrow?
We're talking to the other Nonagon.
But no, man, yeah, absolutely. We love having repeat guests, you know, come back and it's kind of cool too, to get just kind of the interviewee shit out of the way and you can just bullshit about all sorts of different things. And
yeah, I think it'd be really fun. Like back, you know, when clubs are back open and when shows are starting again.
Yeah.
It'd be really fun to talk again and kind of, you know, see how different the conversation is.
Yeah.
Well, you gotta play Lawrence now, man.
Yeah.
I'd love to.
You got origins to that album title, even go back to Lawrence. So
that's true. That's clearly true. I can bore everybody with that story from the stage. That'd be great.
You're right. Right.
You can go play at the Dam.
Turn everything off. Turn everything off. I got a story to tell. Okay, yeah. So the Dam. That's down. Yeah. Ooh, now's the time to get a beer.
exactly.
John from Nonagon, thanks for coming on.
Yeah, we appreciate it.
We had a great time. It's good to get to know you. I'm looking forward to getting my record.
Yeah,
thanks for joining the family, man.
For sure.
It's an honor and a privilege to have you on.
Thanks to Conan
Neutron for hooking us up and linking us together. We appreciate it, and man, we're gonna keep going.
Yep.
Looking forward to you keeping going. So thanks for listening, everybody, to Undetermined, the podcast.
We
on March 27, 2021. John from Nonagon. Buy their shit.
Absolutely.
Thanks, gentlemen.